I'm Francesca Maxime, and this is Currents. The Vatican publishes its guidelines on sex abuse cases. We'll get a breakdown of what it means. He's not a saint, but he plays one on stage. And is this the face of God? Why thousands have turned out to see the Shroud of Turin. Well, good evening. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Matt McClure has the night off. Following reports over the last few months about sexual abuse involving priests, the Vatican this week published for the first time its guidelines for dealing with abuse cases. But what did these guidelines say and what does it all mean? To get answers to those questions and much more, our Natalia Ortiz spoke by phone with Father Gerald Murray, a canon lawyer and the pastor of St. Vincent de Paul Parish in Manhattan.
Thank you so much for joining us, Father Murray.
Good to be with you.
Great. Father, tell us about these guidelines that are in place that the Vatican has released regarding how the Church handles sex abuse allegations by a priest.
Yes, this guide was issued on this past Monday by the Holy See, and it basically laid out for any interested persons the procedures already in place. What happens when a priest is accused of sexual abuse of a minor, what does the Vatican require of the local bishop, and then what does the Vatican do?
Okay. And more or less, what does happen when a sexual abuse allegation of a priest or by a priest occurs?
Right. Well, what's supposed to happen, and that which the guidelines lay out clearly, the local bishop investigates the allegation, and then if he finds that there's a semblance of truth, then he is to forward this information, the results of his investigation, to the Vatican. And then he's also to take measures to restrict the activities of that priest who's been accused. The case will be investigated in Rome by the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith.
Okay.
And then there are three options, essentially, that can happen. The Roman Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith may instruct the local bishop to conduct a trial to arrive at a decision on whether the allegation is proved or not.
Mm-hmm.
The second is what's called an administrative process, which is similar to a trial but is different. It's, an administrative action would be sort of like a bureaucratic solution. You wouldn't have a judge. You would have an administrator looking at it. And so it's a little, it's less onerous than a trial.
I see.
The third possibility is that the Holy See may decide that this case is so grievous, or that in the case of a priest who's already been convicted in a criminal trial in a civil court, then the priest can be directly removed from the priesthood by the Pope himself by a decree.
Okay.
So that's those are the three possibilities.
Father Murray, the Holy See's press office told Catholic News Agency that this isn't actually new, that this is something implemented by John Paul II. So what part of all of this is new?
Well, what's new is there's a clear statement in the third paragraph of this document. Mm-hmm. Civil law concerning reporting of crimes to the appropriate authorities should always be followed.
Okay.
Now, that, of course, is the prudent and wise thing, and many bishops did that in the past,
okay,
but not all of them.
I see.
So it's very clear that the Holy See wants that to happen.
Okay. So it's basically it's just an addendum to what was already there, is what you're saying?
It's a clarification and
okay,
a specification.
Very good. Who bears the major responsibility when it comes to dealing with these issues?
Essentially, it's the local bishop, because
okay,
he is the one who has to react when the accusation comes in. And then he has to conduct an investigation. Now, he usually does that through staff members, priests in his chancery, or lawyers that work for the diocese. But it's up to him to find whether this is a true accusation or not, based on preliminary examination of facts.
Okay, and how involved is the Pope in this case?
Well, then the Pope will get involved only in the sense of once the case has gone to Rome, the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith will decide whether case should then be returned to the local diocese for either a trial or an administrative process, or whether it should go to the desk of the Pope for this decree of removal from the priesthood. Now, the Pope, of course, busy man. He depends on his different departments, including the doctrine of the faith, to handle everyday matters. But, of course, the Pope is the one who is enforcing these rules. He's reacting very strongly to this crisis, and this is the, we can say, the administrative and legal means to arrive at just solutions to these horrible situations.
I see. And so what does the average Catholic, what can they take away from this?
Well, first they have to know that the media does not always report accurately on what the Pope has either done in the past or is doing at the moment.
Okay.
This guide was issued precisely to inform lay people and people who are not canon lawyers about the basic outline of what happens. And it's very clear people should know the Vatican does not sit around and just stare in the sky and wonder what to do. No, they have a definite process, and they're acting on it. Thousands of cases have gone to the Vatican since the year 2002 when this scandal was first exposed.
Right.
And, justice is served. So some cases take longer than others because you have to gather more evidence. And this is where the local bishop's role is so crucial. He has to have a serious evidentiary process to gain knowledge of all the facts. It's not enough simply say so-and-so is accused of a crime,
right,
and I think that he's guilty. No, we have to have more, some evidence to back that up.
What potentially can happen to a priest if found guilty, Father?
Well, he can be removed from the priesthood, dismissal from the clerical state. There's also provision for what's called leading a life of prayer and penance. And that is in the case of older or sick priests who would be taken care of in the sense of put in the church residence, but would not be allowed to function as a priest in public.
I see.
And then there are some cases where there may be a doubt on the part of the judge as to whether the person was guilty of the crime, but there may be reason to think that he should not be allowed to go back into the priesthood.
I see.
Because different factors, past bad actions that may indicate he may not have committed the crime. These are difficult decisions.
Father Murray, we've run out of time, but thank
yep.
you so much for joining us today, and we hope to talk to you again soon.
And that is, as Natalia mentioned, canon lawyer Father Gerald Murray. Well, in related news, the Vatican has said Pope Benedict is open to meeting with more abuse victims. And as we now hear from Rome reports, that could happen as soon as this weekend.
The Pope could meet with victims of sex abuse committed by priests in Malta. The victims have asked to meet with Benedict XVI to heal their wounds and to overcome this trauma. The spokesman for the Vatican, Father Federico Lombardi, has said that even though the trip will be short and the program is intense, he does not rule out the possibility of a potential meeting. He has recognized that one of the priorities of the Pope is to listen to all the victims. So if he cannot meet with them on this trip, he will meet with them at another time. Benedict XVI already met with victims of sexual abuse cases in prior visits to the United States and Australia. Father Lombardi says the Pope is ready to adopt new measures to fight sex abuse, like with possible apostolic visits, meetings with the victims, and expanding methods of prevention and responses.
And the Vatican is also clarifying remarks made yesterday by its Secretary of State. At a press conference in Chile on Tuesday, Cardinal Tarcisio Bertone said there is a link between homosexuality and pedophilia. The Vatican spokesman says the cardinal was not talking about pedophilia in society at large and was not making any medical or psychological assertions. Well, stay tuned. There's much more current straight ahead. When we return, we'll have the day's headlines, including the Pope's prayers for victims of yet another massive earthquake. Welcome back to Currents. I'm Francesca Maxime. Coming up just a bit later, thousands turn out to glimpse a piece of history. But first, let's have a look at the day's headlines. Nebraska is placing tougher restrictions on abortion. The governor there signed two new bills on Tuesday. We get more now from Andrew Ozaki.
Standing here.
The governor's signature on a bill and a new line in the sand of when an abortion can take place.
by taking into account the potential for an unborn child to feel pain and setting a new standard for abortions.
It sets up a challenge of the 37-year-old standard held by the courts of the viability of a fetus outside of a mother's womb, something supporters say they're ready to fight.
I didn't find this bill. It found Nebraska in that we have a provider in this state that wants to perform late-term abortions.
The Speaker of the Legislature, Mike Flood, says he sponsored the bill after Bellevue Dr. Leroy Carhart said he would fill the void left by an abortion doctor murdered in Kansas.
I get referrals from other doctors that say that the fetus is not viable. Then it's my intent to take care of those patients.
But Flood says the fetal pain standard is middle ground that will be upheld.
Reaches a point where he or she is able to feel pain, Nebraska has a greater interest in protecting him or her.
Pro-life advocates say new technology helps their case.
There was no fetal surgery, there was no 4D ultrasound. We now have a window into the womb. We now know what we didn't know in 1973.
I'm quite sure the bill will be challenged.
But pro-choice supporters are confident Nebraska's law will be struck down. While it provides exemptions if a mother's health is in danger, it ignores her mental state and say when a fetus feels pain is unclear.
Viability needs to be determined one-on-one with a woman and her consulting responsible doctor.
And the other bill signed into law yesterday requires abortion doctors in Nebraska to perform a risk evaluation on patients, including screening women for mental health problems and other factors. A West Virginia bishop is calling for a better mine safety after an explosion last week that killed 29 miners. Bishop Michael Bransfield of the Wheeling-Charleston Diocese asked if it's safer to travel in space than it is to work in a West Virginia mine. He added that protecting workers should have at least the same priority as ecological protections. In the Philippines, two bombs exploded on the island of Isabela, damaging a Catholic church. Two people were killed in a subsequent gunfight. No word yet on who's responsible. And at the Vatican today, Pope Benedict called for solidarity for the victims of a magnitude 6.9 earthquake that struck western China, killing at least 400 and injuring thousands more. The Pope says he is spiritually close to the people and asks God for relief in their suffering and courage in this adversity. Well, they may be a hit with young people, but the Twilight series of books are high on the list of the most complained about by parents and educators. A spokeswoman from the American Library Association says vampire novels have been targets of complaint for years, and a lot of those concerns have been focused on the Twilight series. Other books that made the list include The Catcher in the Rye and To Kill a Mockingbird. Well, stay tuned. There's much more Currents coming up. Just ahead, the story of a saint up close and personal. Welcome back. Well, a lot of people might want to be saints, but the man that you're about to meet is actually one. Well, at least on stage he is. Actor Leonardo DeFilippis has made a career portraying some of the best-known Catholic saints, and he is now touring the country in a play about St. John Vianney, the curé of Ars and the patron of parish priests. And in this year for priests, the play's message is particularly timely, and recently our Matt McClure had a chance to talk with Leonardo DeFilippis about his work and about this saint.
Well, Leonardo, thank you so much for joining us here today on Currents. We appreciate your time, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now, St. Luke Productions, tell me a little bit, first of all, about what you do and what St. Luke Productions does.
Well, I've been an actor and a director for a long time, many, many years, many decades, three decades now. And St. Luke Productions is a company I started in 1980 in which that we do religious drama based primarily all on the lives of the saints and from the Gospels. So that's our main thrust.
Okay. Well, that being said, Vianney is the play that is going to be coming pretty close by. It'll be on Long Island not too long from now. It'll also be up in Connecticut. Tell me a little bit about Vianney and, of course, the life of St. John Vianney.
Well, John Vianney is also known as the Curé of Ars, St. John Vianney, and he was born in 1786, right before the French Revolution. So he lives during the terrible time of the Revolution and the Reign of Terror, etc. And then he ends up wanting to become a priest during that time. And he, by tradition, becomes the dumbest seminarian in church history. He just cannot pass and get through the studies. He's so inadequate and ignorant, as he would say. And then he is able to be eventually ordained. And they're so insecure about him doing doing things properly, they send them to this little town called Ars, France, and in near Lyon, and it's basically lost its faith in its way, and he has to rebuild the whole thing after the French Revolution. And he ends up, after many, many difficulties and a lot of resistance from the clergy and the people and everybody, he eventually converts every single soul. So he's the first pastor to ever do anything of that nature. And then a wave of pilgrims start coming from all over Europe to hear confessions. He becomes the greatest confessor in church history, and probably the most attacked saint also by the devil for decades. So it's a real battle. And so tonight, what will happen to those people who come to the performance in the East Coast will see a real battle between the devil and John Vianney, and how he overcomes that.
Right. Now, of course, this is the year for priests. Of course, very important time to have this play be in our area in particular. Tell me a little bit about the importance of having this production going on during the year for priests.
Well, the reason for the Year of the Priest is the 150th anniversary of the death of St. John Vianney, and that's the reason the Holy Father has done this. He's currently the patron saint of all parish priests in the world, and the Pope, in just a very short time, in the close of the year, in June, will declare him the patron saint of all priests in Christian history. So this is quite an incredible phenomenon, that he'll be the patron saint of all the popes, you know, all our major saints, Augustine, Aquinas, all those who are priests, all the different religious orders, etc. And so this really focuses in on what truly is a priest. He's the, as John Paul II would call him, the pastor par excellence. He truly is a model image of the priesthood. And I think, you know, providentially at this time when the church is under such attack, particularly the priesthood, we will see such courage and such a model of charity and holiness that's you know, that it'll really be inspiring to this year for the priesthood. It gives priests, you know, truly something to you know, go after and as example, but to realize who they really are and for the people.
So what about when people go to see this play, what might they find out that they didn't know maybe about St. John Vianney? What are some things that folks might discover?
Well, I think they'll discover an incredible presence of a battle of the satanic, you know, the good and the evil. But I think what they'll really come away, and almost every audience does, is they'll fall in love with this ugly old priest. And they'll just go along with his journey, and they'll see his heart pouring itself out under incredible distress, incredible obstacles and challenges, and that he basically just lays it all out there for the people and for the church. And it makes people truly appreciate the priesthood. It gives them an insight that they never had before. Because as he used to say, whenever you go by church, that means a priest has been there. In other words, the church doesn't even exist without the priest. And what I've learned through this whole process, particularly this year, and this is really why the Year of the Priesthood, is that the key to Christianity is through the lens of the priest. If you understand the priesthood, then you'll understand the presence of God in the Eucharist, the sacraments, because you cannot understand Christianity without the priest, which, of course, is ordained by Christ himself in persona Christi.
Well, I noticed on your website that 52,000 people have seen the play now, so congratulations on all that success. We look forward to seeing you. Of course, as I mentioned, you'll be nearby in Connecticut, also on Long Island. We'll have information about that on our website, and we'll also link up to your website so folks can head on over, take a look at all the different things that St. Luke Productions is doing. Leonardo, thank you so much for being a part of Currents today. We appreciate it.
Oh, thank you so much, Matt.
Thanks.
And if you would like to see the play, Leonardo DeFilippis will be appearing in the New York area next week. We've posted some more information over on our blog. Just visit currentsny.net and click on Riding the Wave. We'll be right back. When we return, for the first time in 10 years, a firsthand look at a piece of history. And finally, one of the hottest tickets in the world. It's not for a play or a movie or even a sports event. It is to see up close and personal a scorched piece of cloth that may be 2,000 years old. Saturday, for the first time in a whole decade, the Shroud of Turin, believed by some to be the burial cloth of Jesus, went on display in Italy. 22,000 people lined up to see the Shroud in its first day alone, and visitors have been streaming by at the rate of 1,000 an hour ever since. For many, it's a once-in-a-lifetime chance to see what may be the most remarkable and controversial relic in the world. We get a closer look tonight from Rome Reports.
The Holy Shroud can be seen in the Cathedral of the Italian city of Turin until May 23rd. 12,000 people visited the exhibit the first day. It started with a mass presided by Cardinal Severino Poletto.
Siamo finalmente arrivati al momento tanto atteso, nel quale i nostri occhi stupiti e commossi possono fermarsi a fissare impressa sulla Santa Sindone, esposta qui davanti a noi, l'immagine silenziosa ma fortemente eloquente di un uomo crocifisso.
The Cardinal points out the Holy Shroud helps reflect on the Passion of Christ. He said observing the marks on the linen helps people understand the suffering that Jesus chose and took on for the love of mankind.
I recommend you go see the Holy Shroud without any prejudices and compare your own suffering with that of Jesus and that of many others who live near and far from us.
The Cardinal recalled the Holy Shroud is not a truth of faith, therefore the Church does not have to take an official position on it. He also did not rule out new scientific studies on the linen.
We have sent requests from scientists to the Holy See because the Pope is the owner of the Shroud. In recent years, they have not directly analyzed the Holy Shroud. But after this latest public display, there will be a new analysis allowed.
It will be necessary to open a new collecting of data using the most modern instruments in order to have this information.
Through this exhibition, the Church aims to get a deeper look into the last moment of Jesus' life and to reflect on the suffering of man. Scientists hope the Church will accept new investigations to learn the truth. The Holy Shroud has not been on public display for 10 years, and it's unknown when it will be shown again.
Well, and the Shroud will get a very important visitor next month when Pope Benedict visits Turin to see the cloth for himself. Well, that is it for tonight. Tomorrow, we'll take you to a special Polish Mass of Remembrance for those who died in last weekend's plane crash. Meantime, remember, we are always online at currentsny.net, and you can follow us on Twitter if you like. You can even become our fan on Facebook. Until next time, I'm Francesca Maxime. Thank you so much for joining us, and have a great night.